Okay, it's on.
Relationship to Shep, and if you feel like it, add permission. If you feel like it, do whatever you want. Do whatever you want.
Oh, sorry. You were interested.
If you Larry, how are you?
Yeah, it'll pick it up.
Don't say anything then. Shouldn't be in there.
Is my song, this one's for you. And you can tell everybody this is a song. And maybe quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope it don't mind. I hope it don't mind that I put down the word. How wonderful life is when you're in the world. Thank you. Those are the sweetest clouds. And you can tell everybody this is my song. And maybe why I've never thought that it's done. I hope it's all mine. I'll put all mine. I'll put it down in the world. How wonderful life while you're in the world. I hope it's all mine. I hope it's all mine. I'll put it down in the world. How wonderful life while you're in the world.
Good. You get it, yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I wanna hold you so much. I'd wanna last forever. And I thank God I'm alive. Just too good to be true.
Friends and colleagues to speak today. They will tell you Shep stories, and there are many, and tell you how they feel. Two of the speakers will read letters from other friends who cannot be here today. There will be a 10-minute intermission because Shep would never have wanted people to be uncomfortable for sitting through the whole program without a break. For those of you who want, this is being streamed on YouTube and will be available for viewing after the service. Rabbi Donald Roberts will open our program. Rabbi Roberts was Shep's spiritual advisor and close friend. He meant much to Shep and to the entire Friedman family. Rabbi Roberts.
The poet has written, after my death, mourn me thus. There was a man, and see, he is no more. Before his time, his life was ended, and the song of his life was broken. Oh, he had one more melody, and now that melody is lost forever. Lost forever. In the rising of the sun and its going down, we remember them. In the blowing of the wind and the chill of winter, we remember them. In the opening of buds and the rebirth of spring, we remember them. The rustling of leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. Amen.
My name is Barbara Perry, and I'm a PA, and I worked in Postal, for many years. I just want to say that I'm honored to be part of the celebration of Shep Friedman's life. He's a very kind and humble man, talented, who we sort of missed. I often refer to him as my work husband. I'd like to thank his wife, Leslie, and his children, Renee and William, for sharing him with us. There's so many memories. Shep joined us about 13 years ago. It wasn't always easy. As with so many close relationships, it just can be difficult. Let's face it, Shep sometimes was difficult to help. No matter how we tried, sometimes it was just a little awkward. He felt 100% responsible for his patients, and he found it very difficult to share those day-to-day tasks with those of us who were trying to support him. After we got to know him and we better understood that, we accepted that totally, and it got easier, and life kind of settled in. And he did come to rely on us as well as us relying on him for his assistance. So he approached every patient with the same kind of fervor, total professionalism and an intensity that was sometimes misconstrued by patients as aloofness. But the patients got to know him, and the ones that saw that sparkle in his eyes, they were the lucky ones, and they figured him out. And then everybody got easy. It was very interesting. The more comfortable they became, the more he shared himself with them. So, let the games begin. Shep's sense of humor extended far beyond patienthood. No one was exempt from the Shepisms. From the beckoning call of ladies from across the hall to the registration clerks for help making phone calls or getting hold of patients or following up to "Good morning, Mrs. Perry," accompanied by a playful smirk, or even the ever popular page at the end of every OR case, "Bill! That was for you, Diana." So we all have very wonderful memories of this terrific guy. The OR was always entertaining. It was filled with teaching, golden oldies, and pimping. Not so much about anatomy or the procedure, but about trivia related to the ever-popular 50s and 60s music. Who is the lead singer of the Shondells anyway? Or who can name the Supremes? Step up now. Then there was the ill-fitting Scrubs incident. You know, the ones with the ties that never fully stay tied? Yes, it was ugly. By the end of shoulder press, his chef struts were around his ankles. He removed his gown, stepped from the column guard gracefully, and walked with dignity to the locker room in his boxers, mumbling something about not feeling self-conscious. Through the years, we've bantered and played. We settled into a comfortable working relationship. I learned to help in a way that he would accept. I finally figured him out and enjoyed him thoroughly. He often accused me of giving him the business, but I told him that wasn't my job. I left that to Leslie. And he deserved it. There was one particularly cold morning I think it was about February. I think it was his first year that he was coming to Colesville. I was running a little late that morning, and the OR was waiting. The roads were treacherous. I came across a Honda sedan in a ditch on Route 145. Your car? Toyota sedan. In front of it, there was a car, there was a gentleman bent over, scooping the snow out of the front wheels, away from the front wheels, and his best side was facing me. I knew the cell phone service in the area was good, and I was running late, feeling a little guilty I was going to hold the OR up, so I continued to wait. When I arrived, I was informed that Dr. Friedman was in a ditch. The maintenance guys were going to rescue him. Awkward. As you can only imagine, the story took on a life of its own. Chef embellished beyond all imagination. I could never live it down. Having left the poor hapless surgeon alone in the ditch to die of hypothermia and starvation. Of course, after that, I had fishtailed just appropriately to throw all the snow and ice on him while yelling expletives out of my window. As a conclusion, I would just like to thank Chef Friedman from the bottom of my heart for being a part of my life. Well, Sheppy, you cared for all of us in a way that we were family, and in the end, I know that we were. My life is better for your presence in it. Godspeed, dear friend.
So, I'm Nick Helenthal. I'm a urologist at Bassett, chief of surgery right now, and actually a neighbor of the Friedmans as well. And I had the unique opportunity of knowing Shep in this regard as a colleague, as a friend, and also as a neighbor. And as a colleague, we all knew Shep was a very hardworking, dedicated, orthopedic surgeon who did everything for his patients, everything he could for his patients, and always advocated for his patients. I didn't know that he had his pants down in the OR ever. I didn't know how to react to that. But we'll hear more about how he was as a colleague and as a physician, I think, from people coming after me. I was asked to review and go over some of his accolades in his life, his medical accolades, and upon reviewing his CV, there are a few things I want to sort of share with the group that actually sort of surprised me. I was unaware of as well. So Shep began his academic career at Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh, where he got a bachelor's in chemistry, and then matriculated in medical school at Albert Einstein College in the Bronx on an Able scholarship. Went through that. And went to orthopedic surgery residency in Montefiore, again in New York City. And from there, he completed, interestingly, not two, but three fellowships, one in sports medicine, one in bone and cartilage transplant, and another in total joint surgery, where I didn't have trouble getting through one fellowship. He did three. During these fellowships, he published a number of peer-reviewed papers and traveled the world giving lectures, academic lectures, both nationally and internationally. One of his fellowships, interestingly, was in Australia. During residency and his fellowships, he was in the Naval Reserve and served our country in that regard. And he eventually landed here at Bassett approximately 13 years ago and worked his way here at Bassett, becoming director of our tissue bank, sort of fitting with his fellowship. And also, most recently, a staunch advocate for sustainable and reusable OR technology sterilizing equipment, some of which we're doing now in our ORs at Bassett today, and if you look to you in the future, I think he was a pioneer and a strong advocate for green sustainability an area where we've not been very good at being green. And so that sort of highlights some of his career. As previously mentioned, I also had the privilege of knowing Shep as a neighbor and friend. And it's sort of interesting, we first met the whole Friedman family, actually the first day we landed in Cooperstown ourselves. We were in the midst of unpacking, the moving van was unloading. Our house was in chaos, the doors were all open, it was a mess. And Michelle, my wife, and I were sort of taking a little bit of a break in the kitchen when the family ambassador, Bruiser, came tearing through our garage, through the kitchen, sort of jumped up and jumped at us a little bit, ran through the living room and out the front door. And we were puzzled and startled and happy it wasn't a bear. But right behind them, the family came, the whole family came. And they didn't run through, they knocked and actually came in. But they came in and introduced themselves and welcomed us to the neighborhood and giving us a plan. And I think Michelle and I really knew at that point that we had amazing neighbors. And, you know, throughout the years, I think it's been very true. We bounced things off each other, some minor, some more major. It's been nice having them as neighbors to be able to do that. And I look forward to continuing that. I think it's also been very rewarding to watch their kids grow up over the last 5 years. And I think, you know, they're a testament to their parents, not that they don't have their own unique talents and abilities, but I think most of you are aware that Renee recently got into a pretty good college. she's got a lot of good colleges, but I just found out today she's going to be going to Harvard. And I think, you know, as this is a celebration of Shep, I think I'd like to, on the behalf of Bassett and Serge, congratulate her on that. That's a good accomplishment. And William, it's been a little bit more personal, I think. I have two young boys, and I think they've, from day one, really been mesmerized by William. His sort of quiet, calm, coolness, his ability to lead and just be surrounded by friends and just be a really nice person. And I can't count the number of times that my boys have come home and said, we saw William Freedom today at the Clark Center. William Freedom said hi, and they were just beaming ear to ear. And even though they don't know your last name is Freedman, they think it's Freedom. it's not William Freedom, it's William Freedman. I thank you for that, for really being a role model personally for my own boys. And we know you will go on as well to do great things. And no pressure there. and so I guess, you know, in conclusion, sort of bringing it around, you know, I think that Shep has sort of left us in body, but his spirit will really live on through his family. The things that his work habits, his ideals, his intellect will live on through them. And I think every time I personally see them, I'll be reminded of Shep. And I would argue, when I was thinking a lot about this, in his passing, I think he died well. And I think a lot of people think I'm crazy for saying that. But he had a lot of family and friends there at the end. And I think he died knowing that his kids will do well in the world. I think if I can die that way, or any of us can, we can truly say we've lived this life, I guess, so to say. So thank you.
Jim Loggy. I've worked with Shep for the past 7 years and met him and have some fond memories. Not like some people who know him much longer than I do, but I'm one of the people that's going to read a letter that Dr. Dukowski has written about the specific experience here. And it's very good. And then I want to say a few words as well. So Dr. Dukowski sends his love. He says, I'm sorry I cannot with you here today in person, so I hope you allow me to join you by thought and story. So it says, we have all have done things that always bring a smile when they are raised back into our memories. Many of these activities are never reported in our professional records, yet they are often things that we hold deepest in our hearts, in heads, with the greatest affection, sense of accomplishment, and joy. It says, I was Shep's personal ballroom dancer. The time was soon approaching Renee's bar mitzvah, and Shep wanted to take her on the floor for her first dance. The only problem was that he had no idea about a waltz. So he approached me one day in the hospital and asked if I could come there in person to the house and teach him how to dance. Since I said, sure. Now, I was soon told by more than one person that even Arthur Murray could mold this piece of clay into something. But two great truths in ballroom dancing were in my favor. If you're watching ballroom dancing on TV, says the in the live audience, or even the dance on the dance floor yourself, for that matter, you realize soon that the first truth of ballroom dancing simply is that no one is looking at the man. The men are all looking at the women are all looking at the women. As long as the man doesn't fall over on his own feet, he stands a chance of looking good on the floor on the dance. The second great truth about ballroom dancing is that it's like you drive like a Ferrari. So too many men take a woman to the dance floor only to throw around with some pseudo macho technique like driving that truck. Serious. Inviting women to dance floor is like going into the Ferrari showroom as well. You gingerly walk up and off up to that salesman, and he hands you, shows you this exquisitely polished car that you're even afraid to touch, if lest you leave a fingerprint. And then the salesman hands you the keys and says, "Why don't you take her out for a spin?" The best thing going for Chef is that Renee was that Ferrari drive. Ira goes on to say that when he arrived that evening at the house, to find Chef, Leslie, Renee, and William had all moved the furniture in the great room, with the fireplace on one side and the large picture windows on the other, it made for a stunning ballroom. Chef played a song for me that he had chosen, and I placed him and Renee in a dance position. How many times can you miss that downbeat for a walk? 10, 20 times, practice. Crossbow hitting a piece of Tardo, it stuck. Then suddenly, once, he had it. There were three, it was there permanently. We moved on to the gentle weave and even another arm turn. I had taught Renee in her cotillion, and her graceful fluidity caught and captured your eyes as Chef steered her around the floor. He readily incorporated the two great truths of ballroom dancing, and they were on their way. We celebrated that evening with a class of Fra Angelica, and I went home. Karen and I were unable to make the bar mitzvah, but I heard all about Chef's dancing the following Monday in the hospital. This person after person came up to me to tell me how magnificently Chef and Renee danced. She looked so beautiful, the Chef confidently led her around the floor in this magnificent dance that is the waltz. I knew that I smiled all day that day. Although I didn't see him myself, I knew Chef had done something that we really discussed in public in the secretive and gentle world of ballroom dancing. That guy flat out kicked ass. With love, Joe Bukowski. I feel very honored to be given this opportunity to read this and to say a few words as well. And I want to thank Richard as well as the Friedman family for allowing me this. I met Shep soon after we arrived here in March, about 7 years ago. There was a picnic I was invited to through a friend who's no longer here. One of the vascular surgeons, Stratton Danes, had invited me to, and my wife and our family, to a picnic. Being new to the area, I wanted to introduce us to some people, and it was at Richie Abay's house, actually. So we were at this picnic, and Chef was one of the first people to come up to me and my wife and tell us that if there's anything we need, please let him know. He knew we were new to the area. It was very comforting at that time. And we struck up a conversation, the two of us. A lot of people may wonder, you know, what kind of conversation or what kind of connection this Italian Catholic from West Virginia and Jewish gentleman from Long Island have in common. So part of it was we talked about Pittsburgh. I was at Duquesne, he was Carnegie Mellon, CMU, so we struck up some similarities. Also, we both, you know, we both have this kindred challenge of height and brotherhood that we share. So that was nice. We're both, you know, pretty furry, but our relationship, I would have to say, is based on, you know, over the years, we've always kind of kept each other, you know, communicating. We have a clinic together on Friday. We always would, you know, share, commiserate, whatever you want to call it, and we had some good times. So this relationship between me and Shep and his family as well, over the time, it's been very, very good, and we feel very honored that I've been able to come and speak here. He's a great guy, and I think that, you know, again, trust, respect, and love, I think you can't beat that. He also had this ability to make us laugh at a few of the dinners. I think somebody could tell his story better, but he would always, this relationship that we had together, was he would talk about being on call and then going home to his house and feeling like his house was not his own at times due to various problems or whatnot, or house guests. A dog was involved as well. But the thing that just struck me and my wife was that we were on the floor laughing so hard, but he had this like imitation of the dog that he could picture him gingerly walking in the house looking for a place to rest. And the dog, would show his teeth. Like, he get this imitation, all of a sudden, going through this imitation of this dog, and I'm like, we love you, Chef. Love you, Leslie, William, Renee.
Who among you loves life and longs to enjoy good for many days? And guard your tongue from evil, your lips from deceitful speech. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Oh,
Galatas before the exerted and worked with Shep Friedman for many years. I came to Bassett about 13 years ago, and Shep followed came after about 4 or 5 months after I arrived. And Leslie, Jeff, William, Renee, definitely will miss him. And I tell you, Shep, as everyone knows, is a family man. He often talked about his family, often. And anyone who's been to the orthopedic, the surgical clinic on a Friday afternoon would see some of the comedy that would take place, especially late in the afternoon. And we're dictating charts and see some of the bantering that went on back and forth. You swear if you were on the watching the show, Ebert and Siskel, right? And the two film critics going after each other. And if anyone ever saw us in the operating room together when we would collaborate on some bigger cases, you'd see us arguing about plates and screws and about doing this or doing that. It was all in good jest, but it was a lot of fun. Some of the stories that I want to share is Shep, I don't know if you know this or not, but Shep was a big fan of Clint Eastwood. That was one of his favorite actors. So when the RNC, the Republican National Convention, took place a number of years ago, the last election, Shep came in going crazy about the fact that Clint Eastwood talked to a chair. He loved that. So Shep, in honor of that tradition, I'm going to assume that you're here, Shep. So I want to tell you one thing. There's a dress code at Bassett Healthcare. I purposely didn't wear a tie today. But going to clinic and showing your chest hairs every single clinic day, day in and day out, was certainly humorous. Some of the other interesting stories that I have to share with you are that a number of years ago, it wasn't good enough just going to medical school once. I actually went twice. I got a second doctoral degree, an MD degree, about 20 years after my first one. And Shep came to my commencement, my graduation in 2007. It was held in San Juan, actually just outside of San Juan, Puerto Rico. And so Shep came all the way down there. And my wife and I had been in Antigua because we had to do some clinical work out there the week before. And so she couldn't go both places. So Shep decided to join me down in Puerto Rico. And he was my roommate for a week. And I'll tell you, that was interesting. When I went out to one day get us some lunch or something, I went to get some sandwiches or something down the road. I come back, and there's Shep's boxers hanging all over the bathroom. I said, "Don't you bring extra underwear with you? You have to wash them on the trip." So that was it. That was interesting. It brought to mind the story of Oscar Madison and Felix Unger. The two of them, the odd couple, we were definitely the odd couple that day. We were trying to figure out who was Oscar and who was Felix. If anyone ever went into Shep's his office, an orthopedic office, you would see how disheveled Shep was when his desk was just had papers up to here, reports going every which way, and you'd have to literally stick your head in the pile and kind of do one of these things to find what he needed to find. Shep, one day, I'll tell you another interesting story. One day, he told me that he loved this wine, this Hunter's Red. I gave him a bottle of Hunter's Red for Hanukkah one year, and it's from the Finger Lakes. And he just loved it so much. He said, let me give you money so you can get a case for me. I said, no, I'll just get the case. So next weekend, I got him the case up in the Finger Lakes. And I said, it's in my car. He goes, well, where's the wine? I said, it's in my car. He said, well, why don't you bring it in? I said, you're going to carry a box of wine to the hospital. So we had this argument about how we have to go back to the parking lot and get the wine. I said, where do you park? He goes, in the parking lot. So what's the difference? Why don't we just go at the end of the day, put it in your car? He goes, well, I wanted to see it. So Shep was there through many of your lives, many of the memorable parts of many people's lives here at Bassett. He was there for graduations, he was there for parties, he was there for fellowship, he was there for comforting, he was there for loving, he was there for anything you can think of. Shep was certainly everyone's friend. So Shep and I, one other thing, sorry, I wanted to tell you is that we went to
we were in Puerto Rico, we had the opportunity to go to the, he called it the Bacardi Rum Factory. And in Puerto Rico, they call it the Bacardi Rum Factory. So we went to, on a tour there. So Shep had a patient who lived in Puerto Rico part of the year, a snowbird. And so they invited us to go to the Bacardi Rum Factory. So we went there, and this gentleman who was there was Leo. He dropped us off there, and we went on this tour. And so Shep's going, listening to the film that they showed at the Bacardi Rum Factory, and the making of the history of Bacardi Rum, and the making of rum, you know, the dark rum versus the white rum. And Shep's really, he's taking notes. Shep's literally taking notes on this. He's got a pen and paper. I said, where'd you get that from? He's like, I got it from the guy over there. What are you taking notes for? I just want to know about this. Shep, you're on vacation. You're going to get a quiz at the end of this. You can't get any C&E for this. Well, I want to do it. Okay. So we're at the end of this tour. They give you a complimentary tickets for a couple of drinks. It's some a rum-based drink, some mojitos. So Shep, so we had his two mojitos, and he said to the guy, well, can I get another mojito? He goes, sir, I can give you two tickets. He goes, isn't that enough? He goes, well, I like it so much, I want to try a third. So he kind of argued with the guy about getting another ticket. I said, Shep, just take one of my tickets. No, I want him to give me another ticket. okay. So on that same trip, the next day, we went to the symphony in San Juan. And the symphony, Leo got his tickets, and they were like, you know, $30 or $40 a piece, the tickets. And so we went to the symphony, and I said, Shep, why are we going to the symphony? You don't really like symphony music, do you? And he goes, no, it's good, it's all right. I said, you like 60s music? He goes, yeah, we'll go to this. And I said, okay, we'll go. So I'm going to the symphony, and I'm sitting next to him, and we have the first or second row, I think we're seated in. And he's fast asleep next to me. Right after it starts. So I measured him a couple of times. He woke up a little bit, and he goes, just leave me alone. All right, Chef. So the whole thing's going on. Next thing you know, it's the end of the symphony. He wakes up. Oh, that's a great symphony, wasn't it? Are you serious? You see the whole thing. So that was Shep Friedman. Some of the buffoonery that went on in our lives, but I'll miss the big guy, and I know all of you will too. God bless you.
Many of you are unaware that Dr. Friedman had a great interest in cows. We dispersed our milking herd in the next year, the heifers that were left. A neighbor had purchased one, and we housed her until it was time for her to calve. Dr. Friedman asked on a regular basis about her. The time came for her to leave. And he just happened to inquire about her, and I said, well, she's ready to go to her new home. He was so excited. We have to have a shower. The entire ACC staff at Colesville was involved one way or another. The girls made cow invitations, and they were sent out to every all of the providers that were going to be there. It was a great time. They made decorations, cow theme, of course. Everyone grabbed the ball and ran with it. Party day was so much fun. A shower for a cow, really? What a spread we had that day, and we have not had a party like that since. But that was not the end of Jade. That's what the cow's name was. Dr. Friedman was very concerned about her missing her original home. He asked if we went to visit. No! Don't you think you should? He asked the question frequently for months and years. At Christmas time, our family would receive a card that had a picture of Jade and her new owner. And I would bring it in and we would post it on the bulletin board in his office. His concern extended beyond his family, friends, and patients. Kathy and I represent a part of the Colesville Regional Hospital ambulatory care nursing staff. When Dr. Friedman first came to Colesville and we were celebrating Nurses Week, he asked if we would wear our nursing school caps and what us. On May 5th, 2003, we did for the first time. The story goes, someone told Dr. Richmond that Dr. Friedman made us do it. He only suggested a request. He was always so delighted to see everyone in white. How professional you all look. To tell the truth, we enjoy doing it for him. The tradition has continued. This past Nurses Day, we donned our caps and whites for a group photo for this special man. Kathy emailed it to Leslie, his comment, oh, caps. This is our tribute from the nursing staff to Colesville. There are a lot of stories, but I kind of like this one because it happens practically every week. When we had to put a cast on a patient, he only really liked to use the white color cast. He felt that it molded better and it rolled on better and so on and so forth. So I would tell the patients what colors we had. We had blue and green and black and of course white. And he would say, no, that's light green, trying to push the color that he really liked to use. So he's rolling on the first layer and he would often say to the patients, what color do you think this is? It's not green. So some of the answers that we got over the years were like pale yellow, smoker's yellow, I don't even know that. Urine color, pale tan, beige, white, and my favorite was glow in the dark green. We had a patient once that was getting married the following weekend, and Dr. Friedman convinced him to wear the white collar. He thought it would be the best thing for him to wear with this suit. So he chose it, but I'm not really sure the patient was convinced. He would occasionally convince patients to use the light green, but when the patient actually saw the color, they would ask for a different color. On a personal note, I'd just like to say what a pleasure it was to work with him. His dedication, his professionalism, and his caring manner. I think he's the only one of the providers other than Barb that drove to Colesville 3 days a week. So we are very blessed to work with
him. This town doesn't have chickens. Good afternoon. My name is Mark McConnell. I'm one of Chef's roommates at Carnegie Mellon University. In Pittsburgh, we went in the late 70s and early 80s. We shared a four-person dorm room for 3 years on campus and a three-bedroom apartment off campus. In Shadyside during his last semester there. Which makes me about the, aside from Leslie and his family, the person who lived with Chef Wallace. Chef was nuclear chemistry and pre-med, and I was an architecture student. He became a doctor, and I became an architect. He lived and studied in the rooms we shared. I just slept there most of my college life was in the studio. But I appreciated Chef's steady presence when I returned after 2 or 3 days working desperately to finish a project. There was a rotation of other roommates, Alan, Tom Kamposky, who's here today, Deborah Ryder, another Alan, and another Mark. But until he left school,
early to apply to school, Shep was a constant for me. Shep was the first new person I met in college. When he came to my, when I came to my dorm with my dad in the first fall of 1977, and Shep opened the door. And he was short, and fit, and tan, and blonde, which apparently was surprising to everybody. from his summer job, he worked outside. So he was friendly and unassuming and a little nervous, as we all were. We both signed up for freshman weekend, which was a very brief end of summer camp to introduce the freshmen to one another and university. We were bused to a camp in the woods with cabins and barbecues and very motivated by the classroom. It was well rehearsed. One of the exercises intended to get us to mingle and remember one another's names involved sitting in a large circle and one by one saying our names together with alliterative and appropriate adjectives. Each successive person had to say not only his or her own name, but also the names of everybody who had preceded them. Shep went first. I still remember the adjective he used. He said he was sexual Shep. Now, I don't know he was certainly a studious Shep. He always sat in the front of the classroom, having done the homework. He was always well prepared, and he preferred the early classes. 8 o'clock was very early for us, because in the classes, it's like Alan McCurdy, who's not here today, but I don't know, a chemical engineering student at the time, told me that he and Tom would go to a later class in the same building as Shep's honors chemistry class. And they did their noisy best to distract him as they went by the room and he was always sitting right there. And they would say rude things to him. He would remain unperturbed. Alan and Tom would break out the soccer ball at intervals each evening in order to blow off some steam, and were so careless about where the ball went, bouncing it off the walls and occasionally a study in Shep. Now and then the ball would clean off the globular metal lap and sat on his desk as well, just as well. After this became routine, he would, eyes down, still studying, just reach down, pick it up, go back to the table, and acknowledge him. That's what he was there to do. He could occasionally be sophomore Shep. He joined a fraternity freshman year and went through the usual hazing rituals of the time. I remember Shep on his knees in our room reciting the Greek alphabet for the bathroom. And some rap about how lowly he was and how amazing the upperclassmen were. They had to make whip battles with their names and sundry Greek letters on them. I wasn't a member, so I don't know what they did with that. In some ways, Shep seemed fully formed at college, responsible, focused, determined. He did not lounge or spend long evenings engaging in abstruse discussions. His discussions tended toward the concrete, things that were to be done. He could, however, be dry and funny now and then, dropping barb comments at the quiet end of the sentence. He could do that. He was not above the occasional practical joke. I would come home from the studio very late and sleep deeply in the middle. One night, the boys rotated the furniture in the room, picked up my mattress with me still sleeping there, and rotated it 180 degrees, so I'd wake up more disoriented than usual. However, they dropped me on the floor. I started awake, and someone, I believe it was Shep, said, "Wait, go back to sleep." They picked me up, completed their task. Consequently, I woke up very confused. Shep was not inclined to be angry. When Tom locked him out of the dorm room, he eventually burst through the door and executed a perfect tackle, and 30 pounds heavier than about 6 inches taller than him, demonstrating also his ability to retain lessons learned. By then, he hadn't played any football for some years. He had to retain information, or share it, Shep. His parents sent frequent care packages containing granola bars, yogurt bars, etc. And Shep was very generous about sharing the contents of these packages, and I certainly had my share. We had a small refrigerator by the door, and which contained these goodies as well as leftovers from the cafeteria. And Shep would do a lap. He'd get up, walk toward the door, you know, walk around. It was like 5 times a night. It was just a routine. It was a break. Study.
shower at Shep. Morning and evening, every day. Every day, without fail. For unsleeping Shep. A room is very large. It was about 20 feet square, 10 foot ceilings with a bathroom and a walk-in closet, and push windows looking out on Fifth Avenue, busy Pittsburgh Street on one side, and onto a lovely garden in the back and survived the much mansion's transition from private home to dormitory. When the wind really blew, the French windows would sometimes pop open, producing rain or snow or leaves into the room. One pair of his windows was right at the head of his bed, and Alan, who had the upper body, reminded me that Shep was the one who usually would get up in the middle of the night. Alan would, sleep off. Shep always seemed to get stuck doing some task like that, taking responsibility. For serious Shep, from our vantage above Fifth and Lower Avenue, we would occasionally hear accidents. Traffic lights were sometimes obscured when people would run on the lights. One particularly bad crash to a crowd, including Shep from our room above. A serial security guard was attempting to give one of the victims CPR. This being the era before cell phones, seeing the terrible shape the person was in, Shep insisted that the guard call for the paramedics immediately. He refused. Why? Shep got very angry and berated the guard. The paramedics arrived too late and the person died at the scene. And Shep remained angry and frustrated with the guard. I think he carried on. That was something that took very seriously. When we took an apartment about half a mile from campus, we had to make some new sacrifices. It wasn't quite as a townhouse in the summer when we rented the thing, but the place leaked heat like a sieve. Our room had two huge windows and a door and a fire escape. It was a reason. That bitter winter, the thermostat was never above 57 degrees. We walked around the apartment and slept in sweaters, sweatshirts, and jackets for months. Mostly, though, it was steady Shep. It could be motherly when the occasion called for it. I think I got one much the worse for the drink, escorted by some men in uniform. And when I woke very much later that day, Shep gave me a stern paternal talking to that my parents would have approved of. A sense of responsibility was loyalty. Were already solidly part of his personality. In many ways, I think Shep in college is probably already the person he would later be. Solid, focused, smart, reliable, determined, and very loyal. After college, we stayed in touch for a while. Shep went here and there, and I went here and there. Shep came to my wedding, and I went to his. Then we fell out of touch, as busy people do. Many years went by, and I received the news of Shep's passing. One morning, my son graduated from college. An awful piece of news. So I felt that I needed to show up. I don't have anything else to offer except the Shep himself. When he paused from his work, Shep had some tips. When he would pause, there were certain things he liked to do or things that came to mind. And one of the things he liked to do was to pester me about my Dudley Do-Right impression, which I don't know if you for those who don't know who that is, he was a cartoon Canadian mountie. He was forever heroic and forever clueless. This is for you, Shep.
Inspector Fenwick, it's not the whiplash. No!
Okay, there'll be a 10-minute intermission. The chef would want you to get up and stretch. We will start promptly.
Must we? say
I'm gonna go
I'm For all you people standing in the back, we have seats up front if you'd like to come up.
At least I think we do have some seats. We have about 15 seats up front. Of course, if you want to stay near the food, I understand. Thank you. Welcome back. Our first speaker will be Dr. Tim Pedley, Chairman of the Board of Bassett Healthcare.
This is a tribute to a husband and father, physician, and friend. I knew Shep Friedman for a relatively short time, far shorter than is the case for many in this room, and I never worked with him professionally. I first met him about 10 years ago when my mother-in-law, now unfortunately deceased, broke her hip when Shep was the orthopedic surgeon on call. He came to see her promptly, conveying both reassuring confidence and genuine concern. During her acute care and later her convalescence, Shep was readily available, patiently answering many questions and responding to the family's concerns. It was evident to all of us that Shep was passionate about anything and everything required for good patient care. We attended the bat and bar mitzvahs of Shep and Leslie's children, Danae and Liam, and it was clear that Judaism and its traditions were an important and very genuine part of his life, more internal and life-affirming than overtly demonstrative, but clearly an essential part of the mourner that bound him and his family together and gave meaning to their lives. It was most unfair and unwarranted. But in some ways, Shep was at his finest during the final illness that ultimately took his life. He had a rare and incurable cancer, and a terrible central feature of this tumor's clinical manifestations was severe, unremitting pain that responded only minimally, and even then for only short periods, to trials and various interventions. It was this aspect that was probably the strongest test of his character. It would have been so easy to give up, but Shep never did. We visited him several times during his illness, and despite his obvious discomfort, he always expressed confidence that his doctors here and in New York would find something that would first block tumor growth and second alleviate his pain. Despite the pain and knowing that his tumor was likely to be untreatable, he remained optimistic that something would be found that would support him to help, at least for a time. On the last occasion I saw him, his children had moved into the master bedroom so the entire family could be together as much of the time as possible. Even under such circumstances, there were high points. Shep was a fine doctor, a loving husband to Leslie, and a wonderful father to Renee and Lou. The example he set during his final illness of how to live under the most stressful and painful circumstances imaginable will remain an enduring example of ungrateful optimism, indomitable spirit, and love of family that should inspire us all. Let me end with excerpts from a poem that seems to me to capture much of Shep's spirit as he fought in a winnable last fight. It's from Death Be Not Proud by John Donne. Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, thou art not so. For those whom thou think'st thou dost overthrow, die not, poor death, when yet canst thou kill me. From rest and sleep, which let thy pictures be, much pleasure, then from thee much, much more flow, and soonest our best men with thee be good. And thus with poison, war, and sickness well, and popular charms can make us sleep as well, and better than thy stroke, why swell'st thou then? One short sleep pass, we wait eternally, and death shall be no more. Death thou shalt die. Thank you.
Hello, she's in an anesthesiologist here, and I've known Shep since his family lived there. They were neighbors of ours down on Fair Street way back when. We met the young family, little kids were tiny, small, not little kids when we go to college. But we're here today not to mourn Shep's passing, but really to celebrate his life's work. He was a dedicated physician whose life was cut way too short. The doctor is compassionate, honest, and kind, and also has the humility to recognize one's limitations and the place to treat, and also to recognize and to treat everyone as an equal. Dr. Friedman, Shep, as he was affectionately known. When I first met him, Shep, I thought Shepherd was his name, but it was Shep was his name, not Shepherd. As he was affectionately known by his colleagues, patients, and friends, embodied that ideal person as a physician. No one could ever say Shep uttered a mean word or treated them with anything less than respect. Shep enjoyed his work. He put in long days. Just ask his family, ask Leslie. There was many a times I saw him drive by my house at 7-8 at night, and I would look at my watch and I'd see him running past my house in his vehicle back home. It was 7-8 o'clock at night, not even on call. And, you know, that's the bar he set for himself. His work ethic was tireless. And his quest for knowledge was unquenchable. His collection of journals rivaled those of the Library of Congress. I mean, in general, I recycle mine with barely a page turned, yet he had stacks of them. And they moved our neighbors, as their neighbors on Fair Street, remember, Leslie? The stacks going up the stairs. What do you do with all those journals? I asked Shep one day, like years later, once I got to know him, I said, Shep, what are you going to do with all these journals? He goes, I plan to read them when I get some free time. I said, Shep, by the time you read that article from 1992, that procedure's outdated already. I mean, what's the point? So that was a running joke. Shep, how's your journals coming? He never got to enjoy that print time, unfortunately. Once he fell ill, I don't know if Shep really expected to return to work anytime soon, but in spirit, he was a physician till the very end, even directing his own care while he was in the bed, at home, in his bedroom, even through the throes of pain. He was a born doctor. He was a natural. He respected his patients and his colleagues and treated us all with the utmost concern, compassion, and respect that he expected that. He put everyone's needs above his own, and he treated each patient as if they were a loving family member. I remember a cold night once, middle of the night, it was a bad fracture of a local member of the community who was also friends of both of ours. And the last thing I wanted to do was a case in the middle of the night. But the chef wasn't just a case. It was actually, you know, to him, it was a person who needed help. And to this day, whenever I see this person, still cannot say enough about the chef and how much he admired his work. They say doctors make the worst patients, but nothing could be further from the truth about the chef. I never heard him complain through the endless setbacks and treatments of his pain. Until the very end, I enjoyed my bedside chats with him. During his term as president of the medical staff, he tried to empower the physicians to be more proactive in the management of our own practice. He was not afraid to speak up against what he saw needed correcting. As a physician once said about Shep, Shep says what most of us think, but are afraid to say. His attitude was positive and determined to accept nothing less from Shep. Well, where did Shep draw his strength? I would have to say he drew from his family, his faith, his friends, from his inner soul, and from his work. In closing, I feel comfortable speaking about him and his family. He lived a life of service to his family, friends, and patients, and to anyone who had the honor and pleasure of knowing him. The time of his departure came too soon. He fought the good fight, and his legacy will live on. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Raymond Goldrick. I'm a urologist at Massachusetts. I've been working here for 14 years, Shep. I pursued Shep by about 6 months, so we pretty much came together and my daughter's in the same class. We were assigned to Colesville every year before, very much. So I got to know Shep very well over the years. I oftentimes used to say this to the family, the woman works hard for Shep Friedman. Examples and workers. And when he got through that cross, the other day, that Shep, he got it to where he said he's a good man. And that's what he talks about. And I think he had a column of work downstate. He was a good man. He figured out all the times he betrayed. He really did. He actually called the general manager. It's a 14-year-old. He called the general manager. And he got him out. I had a group of coaches. What he used to do with medical staff, and he called the general manager. So he was used to do that. Again, it's a very hard worker. He enjoys different treatments. I said he was going to do that. But just one quick, so Richard asked the story that talks about sums up Shep. This is a story I'll never forget. I don't know if most of you work at Bassett or not, but Bassett rarely gives snow day. There's no such thing as a snow day. And probably for a week because of small falls or the great road crews. But one day, about 7 or 8 years ago, I just remember February 14th, 40-inch snowstorm. And I was walking home at night, and the night of this electric drift, and something I did by. And it was serious snow. State of emergency and open, so I said, there's no way, Cobles is open. So I got up in the morning, of course, Cobles knowing that we were supposed to get there if we could. and they've been in all the patients canceled and right now. So I thought, I started. I probably got my started. I had a cup of coffee, I had an old arm, and the TV was on, it was great. Oh, and you got a photo job? Yeah, they were. This part is broken. You need to get the call. You need to get the call. So, Chef, you sure? Yes, it's very important. So, somehow we got out, and they can't get through his road. So, I think he walked half a mile. I don't know how long he walked. So, here in the fire's down, he was all laid out. Desolation, snow. He was a solitary figure. And if I picked him up, and he said, oh, we have to go pick up Nancy's house. So I put Nancy here, I'm not sure if I was happy. So in Pirates Town or Clyde Creek, that's an over the hill road. I had a shovel in my car, and then twice we have to shovel some ground. So I pick up my foot chance and get the focus going. And it was what normally 45 minutes drive was actually. 2.5 hours, 2 hours. It was a long time. But we made it. I had nothing to watch. I was surprised to buy it. I'd like to think, you know, it was life-saving organ transplant. Medication. And no, it was just someone who didn't want to do her stroke the following week. We made sure that everyone was there and the team was there and we drove home and we put there the fun time driving home. I didn't realize what a bad driver I was. So, Chef.
Told me to call him Chef. I just couldn't do it. Even, you know, he kindly stopped correcting me. He has an office next door to my little cubby, and as I guess he does everywhere he worked, he's famous for shouting out stuff like, well, what's Laura's number? I like it, you know, what's my next case? And we were always shouting back and forth. He used to call me from Colmaskill. He was over there 3 days a week. Actually spent more time over there, but I think I talked to him more when he was in Colmaskill than when he was over here. He knew my number. I knew how to get him too. So it was good. Near the end of the day at Colmaskill, he'd call me, ask me what was going on, did he need to come back to the office? And 9 times out of 10, I'd tell him, no, just go home. You know, there's nothing here that can't wait. And as always, he was here till 7:38, 9 o'clock at night, doing his paperwork, running my patients, doing his letters that I would yell at him the next day, saying, you know, I can make the copies, I can mail them out for you. But that was just him, he had to do it all himself. He was quite disorganized on his desk. He knew where things were, I think. But he always teased that one day I'm going to get some of those nice cabinets, those cherry shelves and cabinets that all those new doctors get. Well, he could use a little more storage, so we put in a request for some shelving. And time went by, never heard anything. I started making some phone calls. We'll find him something. Because they couldn't make him something in these times of budget crunches and things. He was going to have to wait for somebody to get rid of something before he could get some new shelving. So one day they came and Ron found something. And the shelf was about this much too short for the space that he had. He wasn't real thrilled with it, but all right, after Ron had said, well, you know, this isn't permanent, we'll keep our eyes open for something else. He also had some speakers. I'm not sure what he used the speakers for, but they were little. And he always thought that there was a way they could break them up and hang them on the wall so they didn't have to be like teetering on his piles on his desk. Unfortunately, they really didn't figure something out. They're still sitting on his stuff. They tried Velcro, they tried all sorts of things, and just nothing seemed to work. They even had some little brackets or something that hung down from the shelving. Well, one day Ron came up with his measuring tape and said, geez, I have some nice cabinets that are taken out of the cancer treatment center. I think he's going to really like these. He came in and measured them up, and sure enough, it was a good fit. So it wasn't long. They were wheeling up the new shelving, or newer shelving. He was pretty happy with that. The stuff from the shelving, the old shelving, sat on the side of his office for a real long time. Kept telling me he was going to get to it. And I kept tripping over stuff every time I had to go over, so I eventually started putting stuff away for him. There's still a few piles in there. He had good intentions. He just, his patience came first. On another note, years ago, staffing in our office was very slim. It was pretty tough going for a while, and he saw me wearing down. He was real concerned and made sure he checked in on me frequently. Always asking, you know, is there anything I can do for you? You know, are you okay? Are you doing okay? He called me just to say hi and see how I was doing. He even went and spoke to management about getting some help. It wasn't long. We were back floating pretty smoothly again. He really went to bat. He really was concerned for me, for our office, for his job that he did, every patient that he dealt with. I'd answer calls for him. He'd still come back and call him. I would relay his message, and he still had to come and just elaborate, and he'd spend another 10 or 15 minutes with patients. He was my hero. He was a devoted orthopedic surgeon. He was devoted to all of his patients, his colleagues. And even through his painful and ugly illness, he was such a trooper. I got to tell him that he was my hero about 6 weeks before he passed. He just said, I really appreciate that. He's left his mark on all of us, and I'm going to miss him. A prayer for abundance of peace. Thank you.
shall arise from the sea, was a proposed solution.
I am quoting an email sent to me last week from a former colleague, Bob Clancy, now the medical director at MedU. And he says, quote, "I've worked with several healthcare organizations over the past 25 years and have to say that Shep was one of the most passionate physicians I've ever worked with when it comes to patient care and fellow physicians. We had many long conversations about his concerns for facilities management, patient safety over the years. Unlike many of us in healthcare, Shep never walked away from a situation that he thought could better the patients or his colleagues without speaking up. He always believed that we could, and more importantly, should be better. At times, this made him less than popular with leadership, both in administration and in his own department. However, unlike some of us who use public forums as a place for grinding axes for personal gain, I can never remember Shep as an advocate for something that would benefit him directly. It was often for improved facilities for our patients or his partners, improved processes for patient care, or improved working conditions for our staff. I learned much from him about standing up for the principles for which we as physicians should always be advocating. As you know, many physician leaders, we need to continue supporting our colleagues in this complex healthcare environment. As employees of a field that has unfortunately had increasing job dissatisfaction nationwide, it is important to recognize those of our colleagues like Shep, whose passion for care of his patients and colleagues often goes unnoticed." End quote. Shep and I are of similar vintages. We trained in New York City, and Shep was always reminding me of our conjoined past. We've heard that he did 3 fellowships. He's very proud that he studied at Montefiore and is always telling us about Stanley Hoppenfeld. I'm sure we've all heard the Stanley stories. Banksley, a British graffiti artist, is noted for saying, "They say you die twice. One time when you stop breathing, and a second time a bit later on, when someone says your name for the last time." Shep will live in the minds and hearts of many in this room for generations to come. Here at Bassett, the medical staff has established the Walter A. Frank Physicians Excellence Award. This award will be given to a medical staff member voted by his or her colleagues to exemplify qualities we all find of value: service to patients, students, colleagues, and community. On May 20th, I was able to inform Shep and his family that he would be one of 2 recipients for this year's award. So in closing, it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the Bassett Network medical staff to present this inaugural award for Walter A. Frank Physicians Excellence posthumously to Shep.
My name is Diana Brickner. I'm just leaving the operating room at Covington Hospital. Chef, it was a pleasure and an honor to have worked with him. He was dedicated and compassionate, caring. We loved him. He loved us. I now understand why he hated the drive to Cobosville, because I went to his home last week, and I wouldn't have driven it either for so many years. He was our champion. He worked hard, he was tireless, he was there long hours. He was frequently in my office, complaining about something, wanting something, yelling at me for something that I had no control over, and then he would come back you know, 10 minutes later, he apologized profusely for what he had done. He had great staff there. He had Barb. He had Flip, who was his tech for years. Anything that he wanted or needed, Flip was there to give it to him and to make sure he had it. I can see him coming into the OR. He would rush in at 10 of 8, throw his bed down, go to the pre-op area, see his patients, work his patients, run into the change, and go right into the OR and make sure that everything was there that he needed, everything was perfect. And then he would say, okay, where's the music? So even though I didn't work directly with him in the OR, I was in there occasionally, and there were times when he would talk about things. He talked about his family. He loved music. There were always quizzes about who sang the song. He was on a kick for a couple of months about sateen pillowcase covers. And he would go on and on and on. He would talk about the old ticking pillowcase covers that we had when we were growing up, and you remember them, you could zipper them and zipper them and wash them. So he went on about, I don't know how long about that, until finally one of our anesthesiologists found them and brought them in and gave them to him. And he was so delighted. He was happy. I'd never seen him so happy when he got those pills. He had a green boots that he wore in the OR, because when he did his knee arthroscopies, there was always water all over the floor. And sometimes when I'm in there, I look on the floor and you need waiters actually to go in there. And he never liked anything on the floor. He didn't like you to put anything on the floor, just soak up the water or anything. One time I went in there and I think it was all over. It was going toward the anesthesia machine, it was on the electrical wires. And I was putting things on the floor and he was yelling at me. And I said, my God, you're going to electrocute us. But then later on, he was fine with it. At one point, we had all heard that our operating room was going to close. It was a room or whatever. And he came down to us and he talked to me about it. And he was very upset about it. And he was very concerned about it. So I believe he was a champion, or one of the champions that helped keep our OR open, and we were very grateful to him for that. Very grateful. A couple of other things that he used to do. Barb had mentioned that at the end of every case that he did, he would scream out, "Bill," as loud as he possibly could. And my office was right down from the OR. And it would be really quiet in the hall and really quiet in my office, and I'd hear him screaming, "Bill!" on the top of, and I'd jump out of my seat, and I'd go down to the OR, and I'd have a ruler in my hand, and I'd open that door, and I'd say to him, "Would you stop doing that to me?" So he would give me a heart attack, and he'd laugh. He would just think that was the funniest thing ever, and I think he did it just for me. The other thing that that really I remember is that he would write me notes. And he would write these notes and he'd send them down from the ambulatory clinic and put them on my desk. And I could never read them. So I had to trot upstairs and say to him, I said to him, and me, I'm a good Catholic girl. I said to him, "It is clear to me, Chef, that you did not go to Catholic school. You would have been practicing your handwriting and I would be able to read that." And he'd laugh. Well, and in spite of everything, we truly miss him. The spirit is there. I know he's with all of us. I know that he's here with us today, and he would have had a wonderful time here today. And I would just like to read this to you. This is authored by Henry Scott Holland. And it is, "Death is nothing at all. It does not count. I have only slipped away into the next room. Nothing has happened. Everything remains exactly as it was. I am I, and you are you. And the old life that we lived so fondly together is untouched, unchanged. Whatever we were to each other, that we still are. Call me by the old familiar name. Speak of me in the easy way which you always used. There's no difference into your tone. Wear no forced air of solemnity or sorrow. Laugh as we always laughed at the little jokes that we enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me, pray for me.
Let my name be ever the household word that it always was. Let it be spoken without an effort, without the ghost of a shadow upon it. Life means all that it ever meant. It is the same as it ever was. There is absolute and unbroken continuity. What is this death but a negligible accident? Why should I be out of line because I am out of sight? I am but waiting for you for an interval, somewhere very near, just round the corner. All is well. Nothing is hurt. Nothing is lost. One brief moment and all will be as it was before. How we shall laugh at the trouble of parting when we meet again.
My name is Carl Superman. I've been in the facet since 2009. And it was my great privilege and good fortune to have worked with Shep for the last 5 years. I came to the facet fresh out of Wisconsin. And I was a little green. And I was a real idealistic and optimistic about future. And I couldn't understand the RO for them in the facet. It's a lot of work for them. And I instantly gravitated towards Shep. I found him to be a steady hand, a valued and trusted mentor, and a respected colleague. Shep had an amazing memory. He could just as easily reel off the similar papers and techniques just as well as naming the founding members of the animals. They had a skill in a dead memory, for which I was so envious. Pertaining to this memorial service, I don't know that he would approve. He would say, why aren't you all at home enjoying this beautiful day with your families? Because when I say that to me, that the union would ask my office and put aside the door and say, well, I'm home. Should be home enjoying the family. You know, he was sick. Shep, I say that. Because I never listened. It's too bad. Shep was blessed with the food he loved and blessed with beautiful family. And I extend my deepest sympathies to his wife, Leslie, who has sympathized and apologized for the experience that Shep had. And to brilliant and incredible children, Renee and Maria. And we can see reflections of Shep's intelligence, humility, humanity, and strength every time he saw him. Shep was so proud. It was hard to believe that it was scarcely a year since William's parents fell. And Shep was squirming around, buying this energy, making sure everyone was having a great time. All of these things were full, and fully recommended as a new path for the people. And if you ever sound happier, or more fulfilled. Shep graduated first from his medical school, a fact that I did not know, but does not surprise me. Shep was a leading man, but the man did not see it. Another fact. Was not surprising. Shep's office is across the hall from mine. His name remains on the door, it remains open, as it always was when he was alive. His office filing system, as you've heard, is notorious. He was a little nervous going into his office because he put something to call on me. But he would say, I know exactly where everything is. And I remember when one of the secretaries said, organizes his house. It's the not do that. Don't touch it, I mean. There's existing there. I believe this was a system of beautiful chaos that was a reflection of his life, his life's work. Where I miss the most is being walk into his office anytime. Share a case, ask about next week, or ask for career advice. You decide to be truthful, and I miss him. We will be missed at staff meetings, where his brand fiery letter provided much needed spice that hung down the administrative diplomacy. We will be missed in the OR, where he used his gift of hands to heal, ease the burden of suffering, and be appropriate. We still found the time to teach food, like we do, or surgery, such as myself. No matter the time, day, or night, in fact, times. I remember my early days of college, being complex, unfair, and needed to be taken care of at 2 a.m. in the morning. I had a shot of help, and he was there for 15 minutes. And we worked through the piece together. He was gracious and generous with his time, even in the wee hours of the morning, and even though we were all day early. Even in the hospital, during the early days of his illness, he was checking up on his patients, making rounds, and still found time doing the next road to with him. God allowed us to deliver the beautiful eulogy to the city, much better than ever, and it made it much more a family. He took it all in. He was a powerful physician, and it was all mine, and it was all of his gifts, and it was all of his gifts. That's what we have worked with since he was gone, and that he was absent every day. Thank you.
Shep Breeden was my best friend. He was the best friend I ever had. He listened to me when I was angry, upset, annoyed, frustrated, confused, depressed, and gave sound advice and counsel, including kicking me in the rear end when I needed it. He always came to assist in surgery when asked. He wanted to help his colleagues not only with the immediate situation, but to assure that every patient, not just his own, received the best care we were capable of. He performed countless hours of administrative work on my behalf. Nobody I've known was better than Shep. I remember many things about Shep with joy. The road trips we took to the Outlet Mall, the movies in Utica, or to various other places. Most of all, I remember the times in the operating room when we scrubbed together. Our conversation was like a comedy routine. Whichever of us was the assistant would kibitz and needle the other, while keeping an eye out for any pending problems. It would make the staff smile, sometimes even laugh, and they would buy a scrub with us. Shep recommended me to Dr. Richmond when I applied to Bassett, probably to Dr. Richmond's future consternation. Shep remembered, though, and I did not, that we had met 15 years earlier when he interviewed with me for a job when he left the Navy. We didn't hire him, though in fairness to us, we needed someone immediately, and he had two more fellowships to go. That was the essence of Shep's character. Someone else might have felt that he never wanted to see someone who rejected him, but Shep could see beyond that. I'd like to read from a book, The Joys of Yiddish by Leo Rostin, which is a lexicon of Yiddish words and phrases. I need to point out, though, that this book was written two generations ago in 1965. Mensch, M-E-N-S-H, or M-E-N-C-H, rhymes with bench, from the German Mensch, person, plural, Menschen, one, a human being, after all, he's a mensch, not an animal. Two, an upright, honorable, decent person. Come on, act like a mensch. Three, someone of consequence. Someone to admire and emulate. Someone of noble character. Now there is a real mensch. It's hard to convey the special sense of respect, dignity, approbation, which can be conveyed by calling someone a mensch. As a child, I often heard it said, the finest thing you can say about a man is that he's a mensch. Jewish children often hear the admonition, behave like a mensch, or be a mensch. The use of the word is uniquely Yiddish in its overtones. The most withering comment one might make on someone's character or conduct is, he did not act like a mensch. To be a mensch has nothing to do with success, wealth, status. A judge can be a schlub, a millionaire can be a momser, a professor can be a schlemiel, a doctor a klutz, a lawyer a bovon. key to being a real mensch is nothing less than character. Rectitude, dignity, a sense of what is right, responsibility and decorum. Chef Friedman is a real mensch. I miss him very much. Her brother to say a few words.
On behalf of Leslie and Renee and William and Chuck's brother Ed and his sister-in-law, and on behalf of myself, I want to give a few thank yous. I'm not going to really talk about Chef right now, but this is from us. First of all, Cooperstown. Leslie and Chef were on their way to interview in Maine, I believe. And after they were coming back from Maine, going back to Hagerstown, Maryland, Chef said, you know, I saw in a journal that there's a hospital in Cooperstown, New York, and they're looking for orthopedists. Do you want to drive by and take a look? Leslie said, sure. And they came here, they were here probably a very short time, and they were in a rush to get back. But they fell in love with Cooperstown. They really liked it. Chef contacted Bassett. Chef came for an interview. They came for another visit, I believe. And they came to Cooperstown. Cooperstown has been very nice to my sister, to the kids, and to Chef. And we want to thank you all for your outpouring, certainly last week at the house for the Shiva services and then Friday night for the Shabbat service. It's just remarkable. I knew Chef's parents. Chef's parents were like my parents, Leslie's parents. They always said, no matter where you live, contribute to your community. And your community will contribute to you. And certainly, Leslie and Chef took it very seriously, living here. Chef was a workaholic. He worked all the time. He was very rarely at home. He very rarely interacted with Cooperstown things like Leslie and the kids have had. But certainly, you know, he had his impact. He loved Cooperstown, no doubt about it, no place else. That you love as much as Cooperstown. On the other hand, I want to talk a minute about Bassett Healthcare. Chef absolutely loved your concept. You loved being able to sneak in, as he said, to the radiology department, or to the pathology department, or to the pharmacy department, or any other department that you could think about. And he said, would you mind, whoever was sitting in there, would you mind, I have a case, I'm not sure about something, could you look at this x-ray, or look at this report, or look at this, or whatever. Nobody ever refused Chef. Chef absolutely adored that. And he liked the camaraderie amongst his colleagues and his staff. And we want to thank you. We know we've heard today how wonderful Chef was to you, and we all know that to be true. But I want to thank you on behalf of our family. We're also, in return, you're showing a lot of love to Chef, both socially, intellectually, professionally. I mean, it just made his life. It really did. And it made seeing our seeing Chef being so happy at Bassett, I know. You know, he always wanted to improve things, wanted to make things better, particularly for the patient. But it really adds a lot to our lives, and we're very grateful. Finally, we knew that the people of Cooperstown and the people affiliated with Bassett wanted a memorial like we had today. Leslie and the kids and I were obviously too upset, and we really couldn't deal with putting this together. Just like everything I feel that I've seen here in Cooperstown in the past, people rose to the occasion. I said to Leslie, I can't do it. And so I said, Leslie, would you mind if we ask Rich Sternberg to organize this? And Leslie said, no problem. In my opinion, Rich Sternberg, with the assistance of Christina Noda, who also rose to the occasion, not only as a friend of Renee, but also as a friend of our family, to help Rich put this together. And Rich is going to go through other names. In my opinion, our opinion, you went above and beyond, particularly Rich. Now, I know Rich is totally devoted to Shep, but he absolutely showed the family something today that, I mean, is beyond what we would ever imagine. A lot of love, a lot of humor, just like Shep would have wanted. Shep's music, and Chef Spirit, would have heard of me. Thank you very much.
First, I'd like to thank all our presenters, some of whom came great distances to be here with us today. Thank you to Bassett Healthcare, Dr. Vance Brown, CEO, and his team, especially Roe Bate, Tom Cormier, the security and housekeeping staff, the securing and having the auditorium ready for us. The students of Cooperstown High School for helping with the setup, breakdown, and ushering. Eileen Anania and her team for the refreshments, which will be served again after the service. Dave Russell for helping me put this on. Jocelyn Wittstein, Shannon Crispin, and Bob Burns for producing the video that you were about to see. Cooperstown Event Rentals and the Coffee Shop Plus. Especially want to express my deep appreciation thanks to Christina Noto, who organized the students, edited and recorded the music and video, and showed me how to play them, who was floor manager during the service. And she still has a little work to do. And to her for the phenomenal support she's been to the Friedman extended family over the last few weeks. And thank you all for coming today. We all appreciate the tremendous support, love, affection you have for Shep, Leslie, Renee, and William, and all of the extended family. Thank you all for coming.
Oh, there we go. That was good.
It's gone. It's gone. There you go.
This way is stringing us along. Just know you're not alone, cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons. They fill you with fear. Trouble that might drag you down. You'll get up, you can always be found. Know you're not alone. I'm gonna make this place your home.
I'm not a bad man.
Sometimes you think
I'm